gets angry. I love it when he throws a bit of a temper tantrum. To say that it was of biblical proportion would be about that. That's a joke.
Working with people.
Tough crowd. Now, in the face of it, let's think about this. When Jesus came into the temple, absolutely zero things were wrong. Nothing was out of place. For Jews of the first century, you had to have the right kind of coin to pay tribute to the temple, and you had to have the right kind of animals to give sacrifice, to say thanks God, and give thanksgiving by sacrificing animals. Those are two things that were synonymous with the proper function of the temple. It would be like today if Jesus came in and said, all these Jews, get them out of here. It's all about chairs. What are you guys doing with all these Jews in here? Every church in the country goes, huh? Really, Jesus? But it's about like that. Normal operating procedure is you go to the temple. People came from all over the world to come to the temple during the Passover. It was what you had to go do. So if you came from Samaria, if you came from Phoenicia, you came from all over the world, you had to come and take whatever coins you had and bring them into the temple coins. And so like at the airport, the guys with the money, the change from the Deutsche Marks and the euros and the dollars and whatever, that's what those guys were doing, right? And Jesus gets angry because he is reorienting them. He is reorienting us. First century, God lived in the temple, where you went to go find God and to go experience God, to go see God, to worship God, was in that place, in the temple. Like you come on Sunday morning, still a little holy in these four walls, right? But Jesus is God. And Jesus is not alone, not the temple. No. He's meek. He's angry. He sees what they're doing, and he reorients them in a very violent kind of a way. It's interesting to note that in John's gospel, John has us having the start of Jesus' ministry. In the other three gospels, this is the last straw that breaks the chief priests and the scribes and all the Roman folks back and says, now we have to kill him. John orients us to a very basic truth of discipleship. I'm preaching about this, and John drives this point home with a force. Discipleship will involve confrontation. It will involve us standing in a particular space and saying, no, God's actually this way, not what I see happening here. And that is hard for us to do. We don't like conflict on the face of it. I know a couple people who likes to fight God. Like every time I talk to that guy, sparring match with this guy because that's just how he is, and I can never back down from him. That's why I was taking bait and they were arguing that, right? But most of us don't enjoy conflict. We just don't. But Jesus says discipleship will involve conflict. It will involve reorienting people towards the goodness of God's presence in the world. What Jesus was saying is that no longer was God present in the temple. God was present in the world. No longer do we only come to experience God in the four walls of this place, but we now can experience God out in the world there. In fact, most of our days and most of our hours are spent not inside these four walls experiencing God, but thank heavens we can find God out in the world. Our job as disciples is to go ahead and see that, to name it, to claim it as a God moment, and to say something about it to anybody else. That's what being a disciple is about. That's how the church grew. People said, look at this thing that we have seen. Look at what we have done. Look at what we have experienced of God. And it wasn't in the temple. It was out in the street. It was out with people they ran into the marketplace. It was a supermarket, right? It was at work. It was wherever they were, where they found God, they proclaimed. Look at what God is doing in the world. John sets this up. Very, very early. It's the second thing that Jesus really does after he comes back from being baptized, being tempted in the wilderness. He does one miracle, which is water and wine for the wedding of Cana in Galilee. And then this is the next thing that happens. He goes to Jerusalem and gets angry and makes a scene.
And in both times, it's looking backwards from wherever the vantage point of John, the gospel writer, is looking backwards at what had happened. And in both points, they remembered what had happened and then pointed to that as a sign of God. Now, we got the whole book, right? We got four gospels. They were just living the spirit experience right among them. We know that Jesus will die and be raised. And in 3 days, that's what happens. And that's too many. But even the narrator wants to put that in for people who might not get it. He wasn't talking about the temple. He was talking about the temple of his body himself. Raised in 3 days. Think about your lives.
Anytime you've had a God moment.
Now, I'm not talking about, like, there are some God moments where the heavens do open up and come down and you're like, whoa! I'm talking about the moments of your life that take time to unfold. As this journey for the disciples is unfolding chapter by chapter, step by step, moment by moment with Jesus, think of your life and where you can look back at a moment and say, aha, there's the start of where God is working in this relationship, in this time, in this way, inside of me. And it's usually most clear after a lot of time has passed. At least I don't pick up on it right away. I have a hard time seeing right in the minute that a conversation I had was really life-giving, where the affirmer I was doing was a call to the priest. And someone would say something to me, and I was like, oh, that's a really nice compliment, thanks. But it'll only be a day or so later when those words actually really sink into what that person was saying or what was happening in that moment for me. The disciples remembered what he had said, and then they believed. John was all about the believing, the true belief, and how they believe, and when they believe. And I think for us as Christians, when we believe is pretty important. In other words, what are we doing here? When we believe, and how we experience the divine, and how we experience that touch in our lives, or that call inside of us to do something we've maybe never done before, but because someone needs help doing it, we go do it. Think of ASP, think of the homeless shelter, the winter shelter that's coming up. We are called outside of ourselves. We do these things and we are changed by it. And hopefully then that leads us to further and deeper belief in the power of God and Christ. My challenge for us is that this sermon is fairly straightforward. You just heard it. That's about it. But what I want to say is it's simple but not easy. To look back over the span of your life and see where God has slowly and surely been a part of your life. Where you've always been with God. And where God has made a way for you to catch up to where God is and you finally get there. Take a look at those moments and look back. Remember and believe. If you're real good, I'll throw out a challenge. Challenge is when those moments happen in your life, remember that that's what God is doing. That God is not just here in this place. God is everywhere. And you can find God everywhere. Notice, mark it in your heart and believe. In the name of God, Father.